أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا ربنا بما علمتنا وزدنا من كرمك علما يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم طهر قلوبنا وأزل عيوبنا وتولنا بالحسنى وزيننا بالتقوى واجمع لنا خيري الآخرة والأولى وارزقنا طاعتك ما أبقيتنا يا رحمن يا رحيم اللهم أخرجنا من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمنا بنور الفهم وعلمنا بالحلم وزيننا بالعلم وجعلنا من الذين يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه يا ذا الجلال والإكرام اللهم افتح علينا فتوح العارفين ووفقنا توفيق الصالحين وجعلنا من المتقربين إليك على علم وهدى وبصيرة يا فتاح يا عليم وصلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين آمين. So inshallah ta'ala we'll, this is the third lesson on the book Al-Arba'un Al-Nawawiyya by Imam Al-Hafiz النووي رحمه الله سبحانه وتعالى ونفعنا بعلومه وبتقواه وببركاته في الدارين أمين. So far we have looked at the introduction of the author, and today inshallah ta'ala we will begin with the first hadith. So الإمام النووي رحمه الله سبحانه وتعالى says عن أمير المؤمنين أبي حفص عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كانت هجرته للدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِ. So he began with the first hadith, which is the hadith, verily actions are by intentions. And in this he is following the a'immah who came before him. The scholars who came before him, they say that it is recommended to begin any work of hadith with the hadith إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. And some of them say not only the works of hadith, but any book of the religion. It should begin with the hadith, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. So this is why, for example, Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari is, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. It didn't have anything to do with the chapter. One of the specific things about Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, is that the heading of the chapters has a very strong relationship with the ahadith in the chapters. There are even works written on just the chapter headings in Sahih al-Bukhari. The ulama say the fiqh of Imam al-Bukhari is gained by examining the labels. How did he, the titles for the chapters in Sahih al-Bukhari. That's how we know the fiqh of Imam al-Bukhari. Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. And the first chapter in Sahih al-Bukhari is on wahi, on the revelation to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this hadith has nothing to do with the revelation in any direct way, but yet he began the Sahih with this hadith. So this was the norm of the early ulama of hadith to begin their session or their books with innamal a'malu binniyat. The hadith innamal a'malu binniyat. Al-Imam Yahya ibn Ma'in rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that this is something, it's, yani, he said it's highly recommended. That I don't know if he meant that fiqh-wise, but, or it's just a matter of encouraging people. Ibn al-Attar rahimahullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the student of Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he said specifically that Al-Imam al-Nawawi started with this hadith in order to follow Al-Imam al-Bukhari specifically. So he said that Imam al-Nawawi is following Imam al-Bukhari. specifically. However, this was the norm of the ulama in general. To begin with, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. Imam al-Khattabi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said this kana عَادَةَ الْأَئِمَّةِ. Yani this was the norm of the a'imma, of the imams of the religion in general. And the purpose for it is obvious, to encourage students to purify their intentions in the studying of hadith specifically, or in reading about the religion in general. That when we are about to read a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, or Quran, which is prior, or books of fiqh, or books of anything that is beneficial to Muslims in the dunya or the akhirah, that we purify our intentions. In fact, some of the ulama of hadith, they say if when you pick up a book of hadith and you start to read the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, if it even occurs to your mind to tell other people about it, if it occurs to the mind to spread it and to share it, not for the blessings of spreading and sharing it, but for some reason related to yourself, that in me teaching this, in me learning this, in me, it gives me some higher rank in the dunya, in the hearts of people, then close the book, put down, don't continue. Because your intention has already become corrupt, and it's a disrespect to the Prophet ﷺ to continue to read his words with an intention that he would not approve, or that he ordered, or we were ordered in the Quran not to have. So this is why Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala began with this hadith. So he said, عن أمير المؤمنين عمر بن الخطاب. So this hadith was narrated, was reported by al-Imam, by Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda, the second Khalifa of Islam. Umar ibn al-Khattab is known, is one of the a'imma of the religion, so reading about his life and studying about him specifically is something that you should do. Take time and read about Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa ardahu. He mentioned Amir al-Mu'mineen. This is the title that he addressed him with, Amir al-Mu'mineen. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu was the first person to have the title Amir al-Mu'mineen generally. The first person to be generally called Amir al-Mu'mineen. When we say generally, we mean Amir of the believers in general. Before Umar ibn al-Khattab, others were called Amir al-Mu'mineen, but the word Mu'mineen in those contexts were specific, they were not general. So for example, Abdullah ibn Jahash, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. Abdullah ibn Jahash, the famous Sahabi, we all know Abdullah ibn Jahash because of the battle of Al-Badr. He was the commander of small armies that will go out, the Saraya, the small military expeditions, where 100 people go, 20, a specific number of Muslims from the army would go out on military expeditions for different purposes. When he was the head of one of those military expeditions, he was called or referred to as Amir al-Mu'mineen. But the word Mu'mineen in those contexts means the leader of a group of the Muslims, of one flank of the army of the Muslims, something like that, not Amir al-Mu'mineen generally. So Umar ibn al-Khattab was the first to be called Amir al-Mu'mineen in general. And the reason for this is because if they had continued with the word Khalifa, it will get very long-winded. Because Khalifa means the one that comes directly after, the successor of. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was Khalifatu Rasulillah. Umar ibn al-Khattab was Khalifatu Khalifati Rasulillah. Uthman was Khalifatu Khalifati Khalifati Rasulillah. So you will have to go on like that. So to cancel, if we have 20, you have the Khalifatu 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 Khalifatu. Nah. Amir al-Mu'mineen. So this term became something that was developed during the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. So he said, عن أمير المؤمنين أبي حفص. Abu Hafs, this was a kunya that was given to him by the Prophet ﷺ. Abu Hafs, the father of Hafs. Yani kuna, these names are sort of honorific names that the Arabs would give to people in order to lift their statuses. This was something in the culture of the Arabs. So the kuna, you'll find something encouraged by the Prophet ﷺ, and he gave kuna to a lot of the companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum, and yani to be given a kunya, to give kunya to others, or to assume a kunya, is something that is still mustahab according to the sharia for people of respect, yani for respectable people, not for lowly people. The people of bid'ah, for example, we don't address them with any kunya, because it's, as we said, it's an honorific title. We're not supposed to honor people who cannot be honored by the religion. So this yani kunya, Abu Hafsin, was given to him by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The word Hafs means a lion. Lion, the animal roar. I don't know if I'm pronouncing. So lion, that Hafs is one of the words for lion. And because of the yani fierceness, in a positive way, the fierceness of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called him Abu Hafsin, yani the father of the lions, because of his character. So this was good. This is not in reference to the children of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. He has a daughter called Hafsa with a ta marbuta. Abu Hafs has nothing to do with that. This was something that, this is a name given to him by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because of his bravery and his ferociousness, or his strength of character. This is the father of lions. So, an Amir al-Mu'minin Abi Hafsin Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu arda. Qala sami'tu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam yaqul. So Umar ibn al-Khattab said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saying. Now this method of narrating is important. So Umar ibn al-Khattab said, I heard. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was one of the companions who were against a lot of narrating of hadith. He didn't like the companions narrating hadith, because in fear of, yani a lot of narrations can lead to mistakes. A lot of narrations can lead to somebody either willfully yani making up something against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or slipping, or it can become a culture. He was afraid that it becomes a culture. It becomes a thing where narrating of hadith becomes a thing, and it takes on a certain yani momentum, and then people who are not careful start doing it just because yani they want to be a part of the trend of narrating hadith. So Umar ibn al-Khattab was not somebody who liked narrating hadith, and he didn't like when other people narrated hadith. And when companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, companions who were yani thiqa, companions who were trustworthy. Now when we say companions who were trustworthy, this is a relative term. When we're talking about the companions and we say trustworthy, it's a relative term. Because all of the companions are trustworthy. Yani this is the belief of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, is that every companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is trustworthy. But some of them might have a higher, yani might be more trustworthy than others. Like for example, some of them, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one companion, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam specifically said that his shahada, his testimony is worth the testimony of two people. So his, yani the trust that we have in him will be more than we have in others. So when some of the more trustworthy of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would narrate hadith, Bara ibn Azib radiallahu anhu, Jabir ibn Abdullah, Umar ibn al-Khattab would ask them for verification. So they would narrate a hadith. I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Umar would say, do you have any witnesses? These are companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are not people that we, anybody, including Umar ibn al-Khattab, including Umar, these are not people that anybody would suspect they're lying, including Umar. Yani this is not an accusation from Umar that you're making up a hadith. It is a demonstration from Umar to the other companions. Take the issue of narrating seriously. If somebody says they heard something from the Prophet ﷺ, we love them and we trust them. but verify that. This is why Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he was compiling the Quran, he was instructed not to put anything down as Quran until you have a witness, including yourself. If you memorize something with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which he did, he's one of the companions who memorized the entire Quran with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in all of the dialects. And if you memorize something but you don't have a second person to verify it, don't put it in the Mus'haf. Nobody's doubting the trustworthiness of Zayd, but this is an attitude that we must have to maintain the trustworthiness of the Quran and the Sunnah. So Umar ibn Khattab would do this to companions. Do you have a second person to verify? So because of his attitude with hadith, he's narrating saying, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ. He's not saying the Prophet said. He's emphasizing, I heard this. I heard this. So he's trying to just emphasize, I'm telling you, I heard this. So he said, سَمِعْتُ, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. Verily, actions are by intentions. We look at the words, yani by themselves, the meaning of the words, and then we'll come back to the meaning of the sentence. إِنَّمَا, so we look at the words individually, just as words, and then we'll come back to what does the sentence mean. إِنَّمَا, the ulama differ, the ulama of Arabic language differ as to what is the purpose of innama as a literary tool, as a literary, a linguistic device. What is the purpose of innama? So majority of the scholars of Arabic linguistics say that innama is for what we call hasar. Hasar is exclusivity. Innama in the Arabic language is a linguistic tool that indicates exclusivity. That if we say innama, subject, and then there's a predicate, the predicate is predicated of the subject and only of the subject. Or the subject is predicated with this predicate only and it cancels everything else. So this is what, so if in this sentence, for example, innama, so they use this linguistic tool, innama. The subject, a'mal, actions. The predicate, by intentions. So those who say that innama is used here for exclusivity say, actions are only by intentions, nothing else. So the exclusivity is, a'mal are exclusively by intentions, mean nothing else. So innama for exclusivity. This is according to majority of the Arabic linguists. There are different schools of Arabic language. So you have the two main schools would be the schools of Basra and the school of Kufa. According to the Basran school, Basra, both Kufa and Basra are places in Iraq. According to the Basran school of Arabic language, innama is not for exclusivity, it is for emphasis. So we're not saying, what they're arguing is that innama is not to say the subject is exclusively predicated with the predicate, but is emphasizing the importance of the predicate in relation to the subject. So in this sentence, for example, if we use the Basran opinion, innama al-a'malu bin-niyat is not saying actions are only by intentions. What it's saying is the most important thing in relation to action is the intention. So either for emphasis or for exclusivity. Innama al-a'malu, the word al-a'mal, plural of amal. Amal means bodily actions, actions of the body, as opposed to af'al, which is a plural of fi'lun. Fi'l means action. Amal means action. Fi'l means any act that comes from the human being. Anything done by the human being. Whether it's an action of the body, whether it's speech, which is essentially an action of the tongue, or whether it's an action of the heart. Love is a fi'l. Hate is a fi'l. Fear is a fi'l, compassion is a fi'l, but they're not a'mal. So a'mal relate more to yani practical actions, actions yani that are, it relates to more of the physical aspect of the human being. So the Prophet ﷺ said, innamal a'malu, verily actions of the body, not actions of the human being, actions of the body, and actions of the body are of two types, the body itself and speech. In that speech is the act of the tongue. So verily actions and speech, basically, verily the words and the actions, bodily actions of a human being, bin niyat, is by intention. Niyya is the last stage of the mental part of the decision of a human being. When a person does an action, that act indicates the, or that act is preceded most of the times by a mental process that led to that act. This is called af'al. If it's not, then it's not called an act, it is called infi'al. Something that just happened without a mental process behind it is something that it just happened. It's infi'al as opposed to af'al. The movements of the blinking, nobody sit down and think about blinking. Blinking just happens. So it's not part of the actions of a person. These are acts that happen to a person despite them wanting or not wanting. They're involuntary actions of the human being. So, so niyya is the last stage of the mental process, the part of the decision of a human being. And before that, there are other levels that happen. So before that, there's something called hajis. And hajis is just when a thought occurs to somebody. So somebody is just sitting and just a thought comes to them, hey, drink some water, eat something, order pizza. It just comes. That is just called hajis. That's not an intention. It comes and it goes. So somebody can say, I had a hajis. I had this just a quick thought. Back in the day when they used to do subliminal advertisement, I guess they still do, but it's illegal in many parts of the world. So while you're watching normal programming, they'll just flash an image of a product very fast on the screen. So the eyes won't pick it up, it's very fast. But the belief is, theoretically, they say that it registers in the mind. That comes to mind, that is a hajj. You know, so I had an intention to get, it's just that. So the hajj, if it lingers a bit, then some of the ulama call it lamma, or some of them call it, so either it's a lamma or it's just a khatir. So if it lingers for a while, we call it a khatir. I don't know how to translate these terms. So it's more of a, it's an elongated hajj. It's just a thought. And then if it lingers more, that it becomes a mental back and forth, this is called hadith al-nafs, where you're like, should I or shouldn't I? But all of you, one, two, three, at this point, it's yet not called a niyyah. Then somebody has an azm. After all of that, you actually now decide, I will. So I will get the pizza. This is called azm. And it is also called niyatun urfiyya, but not niyatun shar'iyya. Urfiyya meaning that generally it is acknowledged by people as being an intention. An azm, a firm decision to do, is generally thought of by people as an intention. Hajj is not here as yet. If somebody says, I decide to make Hajj next year, they already start putting aside the money, already started making plans for accommodations, already called the travel agent, put my name, all of that is already done. You have a decision. It's not yet an intention by Sharia, though it's an intention urfan. Yani generally, it is acknowledged by people as an intention. So at this stage, we can use the word niyyah. But it would only be a niyyah in a non-shar'i sense. So someone say, hey, you're going to make hajj? I intend to. You can use the word intend, because it passed all of the other stages that we mentioned. It's actually now a decision. But when somebody says, oh, I intend, does that mean that you actually start the process? Like shar'an. By sharia, is it called an intention? No, and we'll discuss why in a bit. It's not shar'i, it's not called niyyah. So the sharia doesn't recognize it as an intention, but it is an intention generally. It has some effects in the sharia, but it's not what the sharia calls intention. That's clear? It has impact in the sharia. When the time of dhuhr comes, so any salah, I'm just using dhuhr as an example. The time of a prayer comes, and somebody intends not to pray at the beginning of the time. I'm going to pray later. That decision, that intention to pray later on, removes the sin of not praying if the person dies before the opportunity to pray. So once the time comes, the obligation comes with it. If the time comes and you fulfill all of the conditions for the obligation of prayer, you're mature, sane, adult, you have to pray. So the obligation comes. If somebody dies not doing it, they die as neglecting an obligation, because the obligation was there, is applicable, but you didn't do what you're supposed to do. If you had made an intention at the beginning of the time, I intend to pray later in the time, and you die without doing the prayer, the intention removes the sin of not praying. Because you have time, the sharia gave you time, and you intended to. You can't be neglectful. If somebody intend, they're not neglecting. But if somebody doesn't make that intention, they die with the sin of neglecting. Why? Because you didn't even bother. This is an obligation. It's there. It didn't even occur to your mind that I have to do X, Y, Z. It didn't come to mind. So it has an impact in the sharia. Same thing with hajj. If it becomes wajib, you didn't do it, you die before the opportunity. If you had the intention to do it, at some point then it removes the sin, as opposed to somebody not even intending to do it. But yet the sharia does not consider that decision a niyyah. So make that distinction. It has an impact according to sharia, but is not recognized as a shar'i intention. A shar'i intention, we'll come to that in a bit. So he says, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. So then what is a niyyah? Shar'an. According to sharia, what is a niyyah? A niyyah is the specific intention that accompanies the beginning of a specific act that requires an intention. It is the specific intention that accompanies the first integral of an act that requires an intention. That is what the sharia recognizes as a niyyah. So the first integral of salah is the takbir. While we're doing the takbir, takbiratul ihram, the heart says, I intend to pray salatul dhuhr, or asr, maghrib, isha. That I intend to pray the fard of maghrib, that's the intention that the sharia calls intention. Same thing for all of the other acts of worship. And in some of them, it cannot be at the beginning, so there's an allowance for it to proceed. Like fasting, we cannot do it at the beginning, so it proceeds. It's done the night before. But that is what the sharia calls intention, or that is what is called intention according to sharia. So those are innama, yani al-a'mal, niyat. Now we'll go back to the sentence, and we'll explain what is the meaning of the sentence, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. So, the ulama differ here, because what is it saying? إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. Actions are by intention. What does that mean? So the ba here, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. It can either be ba السَّبَبِيَّةِ, which means that the a'mal happened because of the intention. This is what in the Arabic language, ba'u sababiyya means that something is actualized by something else. Huh? The reason or the thing with which it becomes real or actual. So it can be, for example, I passed my exam by studying. That by, yani, through or because of, yani, so the success in the exams happened, why? Yani, is actual, it was actualized through my studying. This is in the Arabic language, it's called ba' al-sababiyya, right? So the plants grow because of sunshine, water, all of that, oxygen, by that ba' sababiyya. So in the, some of the ulama say this ba' here is of that type. Innama al-a'malu bin-niyyat. Some say it's musahaba. In the first lesson, we talk about ba' al-musahaba. Ba' al-musahaba is that this thing accompanies this thing. I walked along the fence. Marartu bis-suri. I walked, yani the walking happened side by side with the fence. I came with Zayd. My coming happened simultaneous with the coming, yani alongside the coming of Zayd. So ba in the Arabic language can be musahaba. This accompanies that. So some of them say the ba here is that type of ba. What is the consequence of the difference of opinion here? If we say that the ba here is sababiyya, then we're saying the intention is a part of the act itself. The intention is an actual constituent part of the action itself. The intention is a part of the act. It'll be like, for example, if we use the same ba, if we say, for example, the car runs because of the engine. I mean, the car, so we say the car is yani B engine. It runs B, the same ba, the engine. Meaning this engine is part of the car itself. It doesn't mean that only the engine caused the car to move. You need other elements, the wheels and all that. But until, so what you have is like, the car without the engine will be like, let's just call it 90%. It's not 100%. So it's not complete. It's not yet a full car. It is complete and fulfills its purpose only by the addition of the engine. So in the same way, if we say ba here is sababiyya, then we're saying that the act is not complete until there is the intention to complete it. So the act, yani the intention is part of the actual constituents of the act itself. So the act is whatever it's composed of plus the intention. So it's a part of it. If we say that the ba is musahaba, we're saying it's not a part of it. It's a condition for it. It's a prerequisite for it. A prerequisite, yani, we can say it's musahaba, it accompanies. Like a prerequisite, it precedes the act. It's outside of the act. It's not a part of the act, but it must accompany the act. Wudu is a condition for salah. It's not a part of the prayer, but the prayer cannot happen without the wudu. And the wudu must precede it and last through the entire prayer. It must accompany musahaba, and it must accompany the entire prayer. If the wudu stops at any point, then the prayer stops. Though the wudu is not directly a part of the prayer. So if we say the ba is sababiyya, then we're making the intention a part of the act. In Arabic we say shatrun, it's part of. Or if we say it's musahaba, it becomes shartun, it's a condition of. And the ulama differ. In the Shafi'i school, we say it's sababiyya, because the intention is part of the act itself. Intention is part of the act. Now, there's difference of opinion in the madhab, but this is the mu'tamad of the madhab. So the intention is a part. The intention for wudu is a part of the wudu. It's not a condition for the wudu. The intention of the prayer is part of the prayer. It's not a condition for the validity of the prayer. This is why in the Shafi'i school, it has to be accompanying the takbiratul ihram, not before. The intention is what we make while we start the prayer, not what we have before we start the prayer. And same thing for the other acts that is necessary. So, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ Verily, actions are by intentions. What does that mean? The actions are by the intention. So you can, in Arabic language, there's taqdeer. Certain things are absent and we have to fill it in the sentence. So here, what is, the ulama differ, what do we add? Actions are by intentions, what does that mean? What do we add to make the sentence mean something? So some of them say, we add the word validity, siha. Verily, the validity of an act is by the intention. إِنَّمَا صِحَّةُ الْأَعْمَالِ بِالنِّيَّاتِ Verily, the validity of an act is determined by the intention, or is made complete with the intention, or is actualized with the intention. So if the intention is not there, then the act is invalid. If somebody said, I prayed, but I didn't have an intention, we say the salah is invalid. Somebody say, I made wudu, but without an intention, we say the wudu is invalid. If somebody fasted without an intention, the fasting is invalid. So verily, the validity of an act is by the intention of the act. The intention is necessary for the validity. So, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ إِنَّمَا صِحَّةُ الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ We can also add the word the حساب. إنما الأعمال يحسب or يحسب بالنيات. It counts. It is the rewards of it is determined by the intention of it. Meaning, what counts in an act is the intention. So verily, an action is considered by its intention. So, or we can say, verily, an act is determined by the intention. And determined here means what the act is determined by the intention. So, here are three things. When we say what the act is, we mean in order to differentiate it from other things. When we take a bath, for example, just to clean ourselves, that's a bath. If we take a bath for a wajib bath of ghusl, whenever it's necessary, it can be the same thing. All of the form of the ghusl shar'i is just sunnah. It's just recommended, it's not wajib. What is wajib in a fard ghusl is that water covers the entire body. So we can have a normal bath with pure and purifying water that covers the entire body, and it can look just like a normal bath. What separates this one from that one? The intention. One is just to go to work and smell fresh. The other one is to remove janaba. What make that distinction? Nothing in the form, nothing in the water, nothing in the shower. The intention. So it is determined by. If I pray dhuhr and I pray asr, both are four raka'at, silent, they all resemble one another. What makes the difference? Intention. So these are three things. Now, these three things are what we call the purposes of intention. One, tasheeh, to make it valid. Ta, sad, ha, ya, ha, tasheeh. So one of the purposes of intention is to make something valid. Without the intention, the act is invalid, as in the examples we mentioned. Or tahseel. Ta, ha, sad, ya, lam. So tasheehun or tahseelun. Tahseel means the rewards that we get. What we get, what is obtained. Tasheeh means to make correct. Tahseel means obtainment. What we obtain from an act is by the intention, determined by the intention. And then the third is what we call tafseel. Ta, fa, sad, ya, lam. Tafseel, which means to differentiate. So the purposes of intention is to make valid, to determine what is obtained, and to differentiate. Differentiation. So tahseelun, tasheehun, wa tahseelun, wa tafseelun. These are the three purposes of the intention. Some, yani one of these, may apply to all acts. So tasheeh, yani some actions of the three, all three may not apply to some actions. Two might apply to some actions. One might apply to some actions. But the purposes of intention in general are these three. So some actions, for example, the intention is not necessary for the validity. So in those cases, we won't say that one of the purposes of the intention in relation to those acts is to make valid, because some of them don't need intention to be valid. The nature of the act itself is such that it does not need an intention. For example, the recitation of Quran. Nobody needs, I intend to recite Quran. Why? Because you can only recite Quran by it being Quran. Right? So the asl, yani the initials, the original state of the Quran is that it is in its Quranic state. When recited, it is recited as Quran automatically. What we need the intention for is to take it out of being Quran. So in the case of recitation, tasheeh doesn't apply, but tafseel applies. Differentiation. So to make the recitation of Quran other than the recitation of the Quran, somebody needs an intention to take it out of being Quran. So for example, we can recite Quran as being dhikr. Women in their menstruation cannot recite Quran. That's one of the things that are haram for a woman in menstruation. But can she recite Quran not as Quran, but Quran as dhikr? Yes. So if a woman has a wird, every day she recites Qul huwallahu ahad, falaq, nas, 10 times in the morning, 10 times. In the menstruation, can she do that? Yes. Can she do it with the intention of recitation? No. If she does it with no intention, is that haram? Yes. Because we said that in recitation of Quran is not one that needs an intention to make it a recitation of Quran. Its automatic original state is Quran. So as soon as it's recited, it is Quran. Only an intention can stop it from being Quran. And the intention that takes it out of being Quran can only be an intention to take it to something that is permissible. Right? Like dhikr. If somebody takes it with an intention to something that is not permissible, A, the intention doesn't count, it's invalid. And B, the act is haram, and sometimes it can be kufr. So if somebody said, for example, I'm going to recite Quran as entertainment, is that permissible or not? It's not permissible. It's haram. This is why singing the Quran in other than the tones that are permissible is not permissible. It's either makruh or haram. So like, for example, there are videos of people singing the Quran in the, according to the musical scales of operas. Operas, I don't know how to pronounce that. This is not permissible. It's not permissible at all. It's haram to listen to. If somebody said, hey, I came across a guy who does it, and he sounds really nice, and it's like, I listen, it's haram to listen to him. If you can stop him, it's wajib to stop him. If he's unstoppable, meaning that he's not stopping, he's resistant, people talk to him, he's resistant, still does it, it's wajib for the Muslim authorities to stop him however they can. If that means to arrest him, then they have to arrest him. Lock him. If it comes to that, I'm not saying go grab the guy and arrest him just like that. Just if it comes to that. In other words, it's haram to the point that you have to do everything in your power to stop it. So that when we say the intention takes it out of being Qur'ani and into something that is permissible. Not just take it out and make it anything. So in the Shafi'i school, for example, somebody steals some clothes to cover his awrah. And then steals a mat, a prayer mat. So he's praying on a stolen item, in stolen items. Is his prayer valid in the Shafi'i school? Yes. Because the validity relates to the prayer. Was the prayer correct in terms of fulfilling the arkan, the shurut and all of that? Yeah, then the prayer is valid. The act of praying in a stolen, in stolen clothes, haram. The act of praying on a stolen mat, haram. But the prayer, valid. Right? If somebody steals and gives sadaqah, here becomes, because the act of sadaqah is the giving of the thing, and a condition is you have to own the thing. So the sadaqah is invalid. But the person who received it, in terms of showing gratitude, does he still have to show gratitude or not? I'm hungry, a guy stole some food, gave it to me. The food is haram, from his end. If I didn't know about it, it's okay for me to eat it. I ate the food. I found out, oh, that's stolen food. Do I now owe the person gratitude? Either mini wajib or mustahab? In the Shafi'i school, yes. Because the act of him being generous to you and you benefiting and you satisfy your hunger, that was still an act of generosity. For him, it was haram to do. But he was still generous to you. So I say, I appreciate what you did for me. I do not appreciate that you've done something haram. He didn't have to give it to you. That's an act of kindness. You benefit from it. You could have suffered if he didn't. So that you thought about me, that you gave it to me, that you did all, alhamdulillah, thank you. The fact that you stole it, I cannot condone that, so I can't thank you for that. I do not approve of you stealing it, but I am happy you gave it. Yeah. Okay, of the, yeah. So in this case, I'll continue. If at the end it's still not clear, I'll come back to it. So in this case, we said, so of these are three purposes. Not all of them apply to every action. So some actions, only one of them may apply to them. Only two of them may apply to them. The one that we're doing right now is an example of where tafsil and tahsil applies, but not tasheeh. So qira'ah does not need an intention for it to be valid. It's valid without an intention. So if I recite Qur'an, I don't have to say intend to recite Qur'an. Why? Because Qur'an by itself is Qur'an, cannot be anything else. The original state of Qur'an is that it is Qur'an, but tahseel applies and tafseel applies. Tahseel, the intention, the reward of recitation is determined by the intention. The reward or lack of reward. If somebody says, I am going to recite Qur'an in order to beg. So you're, number one, you're not rewarded in the akhirah. And the money that you gain is not halal. According to the Shafi'i school. People go around, like you see them walking around in the pavements and stuff like that. They want to beg. They don't come up to you and ask you for money. They come and they start to recite Surah Yasin and make... And then they want you, because I recited beautiful for you, give me something. If the recitation, the intention is to get something is haram, we're not allowed to give them that money for the recitation of the Quran, like that, if they're doing it to beg. So begging by using the Quran, can. So tahseel, what is the reward? Tafseel applies, why? Because now you took it out of Quran, of being Quran to being a tool of beggary, and that's haram. So tahseel and tafseel applies. You need to make the Quran. Tahseel, for example, I recite the Quran and give the reward to the dead. The validity doesn't need an intention, but to give the reward to somebody who's passed away, the intention matters. And it's halal according to majority of the later ulama in all four schools. In the earlier ulama, some of them differ. Imam Shafi'i, there are some reports where he was against it, some of them where he wasn't sure. But the later ulama of the Shafi'i school, all of them agree that it's something that is permissible. Especially if it's in the place where the dead is. Because the Quran recited in any place brings barakah to that place. So if you recite it at the grave, you recite it in the house, you recite, it brings barakah by the agreement of the ulama. So, tahseel. But to make it a valid qira'ah, no. Is that one clear? There are other actions like recitation of the Quran, like the adhan. The adhan, same thing applies to the adhan. Adhan is only adhan. So no, the person who gives the adhan doesn't need an intention to give the adhan. Or to remove something harmful from the road. It's an act of worship. You see a nail on the streets, you want to move it so it doesn't pop anybody's tires. That is an act of worship. But you don't need an intention for it to be valid. Why? Because it happens. If I move something, it happens. The harm is moved. So tasheeh doesn't apply to it. But tahseel applies. Am I going to be rewarded for that? Yet that applies to what? That applies. Because I can just do it for no reason. Or I can do it with the intention of following the hadith of removing something harmful for the road as an act of sadaqah. Now I'm rewarded as for implementing a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. That becomes an act of worship. So you get the reward of removing the harm and you get the reward of following the Prophet ﷺ. So tahseel but not tasheeh. Right? Paying back your debts. Same thing. I owe money. When I'm giving that back, while giving it back, I don't need an intention for it to be valid. Right? So for example, if I did need an intention, if I gave it without an intention, I still owe the person. If I need it, if the intention makes it valid. Because now if the intention is absent, the act is invalid. So do I still owe the person? The debt is unpaid? No, the debt was paid. I don't need an intention for it to be valid. But I do need an intention for the reward. Because paying back what you owe is part of the Sharia, it's wajib. So I'm fulfilling an obligation. I intend to fulfill my obligation. You're rewarded for that intention. So it's clear, right? So tasheeh, the functions of intentions, tasheeh, to make something valid. Tahseel, to gain a reward. Tafseel, to differentiate it from others. You need one act of worship from another act of worship like Dhuhr and Asr. Or a wajib from a nafil. Fajr to raka'ah. And you can do it silently because reading aloud is only mustahab. A sunnah to raka'ah. What makes one a fard and one a sunnah? The intention. So we said tasheehun wa tahseelun wa tafseel. And then we said that not all three applies to every action. So some of it, tahseel apply to all actions. Tafseel applies to some actions. And tasheeh applies to some actions. The detail of all of this is learnt in the books of fiqh. And later on, a branch of fiqh that developed as an independent subject called qawa'id fiqhiyya. This is also something dealt with in al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. Yani the studying of fiqhi principles or the maxims of Islamic law. So tahseelun wa tafseelun wa tahseelun. So all of those three are included in the ba. Innama al-a'malu binniyat. The validity of an act is by the intention, the reward of an act is by the intention, and to determine what an act is and to separate it from other acts are determined by the intention. Innama al-a'malu binniyati. And then he said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before we go on, there are certain things that are usually discussed by the ulama as it relates to intention. So there's a couplet of poetry that combines them where they say, حَقِيقَةُ حُكْمٍ مَحَلٍ وَزَمَنٍ كَيْفِيَةُ شَرْطٍ وَمَقْصُودٍ حَسَنٍ, which means the first is حَقِيقَة. They discuss what is the reality of an intention. And we already spoke about that. The reality of the intention according to Sharia is what is intended, yani the intention that accompanies the first integral of an act of worship or of an act that needs an intention. That's the reality of the intention according to Sharia. Outside of Sharia, the reality of an intention is the thing that the person hopes to gain from the act. The reality of an intention in Sharia, when we say reality in Sharia, what counts according to the Sharia only? And that is what is, yani the intention that accompanies the first integral of an act. That's the reality of it. Nawaitu an usalliya fard al-dhuhri. I intend to pray the fard of dhuhr. That is the reality of your intention according to Sharia. Meaning that that's all the Sharia is concerned about as it relates to your intention. The reality of it in other than Sharia, meaning in reality between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is what do you hope to gain out of the action. Right? So for example, if somebody intends to pray dhuhr in the way we just mentioned and prays the dhuhr, and he fulfills all of the other arkan, does all of the conditions of the prayer, goes to a mufti and say, is my prayer valid? The mufti will ask these questions. Did you make your intention? Yes. What was the intention? Nawaitu an usalliya fard adh-dhuhr. Did you do all of the arkan? Yes. Did you fulfill all of the shurut? Yes. Your prayer is valid. You don't need to repeat it. Then the person said, but I only prayed so that my mother would give me $100. He says to the mufti, do I need to repray the prayer? No, you don't need to. Why? Because the reality in terms of Sharia is that everything was fulfilled. The reality of your intention between you and Allah, all you gained was $100, nothing else. But you don't have to repray. If somebody feels, I need to repray this. So the Sharia doesn't require you to do it. But if somebody feels, you know what, I think I owe this to Allah Azza wa Jalla, then go ahead, do that. There's one alim who said that he used to always be in the front row. Al-Imam al-Qushayri, rahimahullah, mentioned this in Risalat al-Qushayriya, in Tasawwuf. He said that one alim used to be in the jama'ah for 40 years, in the front saf. Then one day he was late, and he said, for one day, I saw the back of the neck of another person in prayer, meaning I was not in the front row, I was in the second row. Or maybe third, doesn't necessitate that it's the second. But he's not in the front saf. And he said, I felt bad because of that. I was thinking that, oh, like I'm going to look bad to these people. For 40 years in the front saf, now I'm the second, people are going to look at me differently. He said, then I realized I was in the front saf for 40 years for other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. He said, I re-prayed the prayers of 40 years. He felt I actually now owe prayers to Allah. I was praying for other than Allah. Being late caused him this realization. So if somebody feels I need, but shara'an you don't. So the reality of it shara'an is that we've mentioned, other than the sharia, is what you hope to gain from the reward. The hukum of it is that it's wajib in most cases. So we said that the things they discuss is haqiqa, its reality. Second, what is its hukum? What is the legal ruling of an intention? The legal ruling of intention is that most of the times it's wajib. So it's wajib for salah. It's wajib in fasting, wajib in zakah, wajib in hajj. Haqiqa, its reality, its hukum, its mahal, its place. What is the place of intention? So the place of intention is the heart. The Prophet ﷺ said, "At-taqwa hahuna." At-taqwa is here, and he pointed to his heart. So the place of the intention is the heart. So there are consequences to that. For example, if somebody intends to do something and what he says on the tongue differs from the heart, what does he do? So for example, somebody wants to pray. He's praying dhuhr. In the heart he intends dhuhr, but he says with his tongue asr. Is the prayer valid? Yeah. Why? Because the place of intention is not the tongue, the place of the intention is the heart. So mahalluha is the heart. Zaman, the time. When do we have to make the intention? As we said, most cases, it accompanies the first integral act of the action that requires intention. The first integral of salah is the takbirat al-ihram. So the intention must be present there. The first integral of wudu is washing the face. So the intention must be present there. Yani for the fard of wudu. Before that, we make the intention of the sunnahs of wudu. We wash the hands, the mouth, the nose. We intend to do the sunan of wudu. When we do the face, we intend to do the fard of wudu. So the zaman, the time is, in most cases, what we've mentioned. In some cases, there is an exception because it cannot be done. Like fasting, the intention is done during the night before the fasting. For zakah, it can be done when we separate the money. And some of them require when we give it to the poor or when we give it to somebody to distribute to the poor. But when it's actually handed over by that person, we don't need to. So they need to call you. Of course, now we can imagine where they call, but back in the day, there's no calling. But now we don't need to call. You give the money to somebody, your representative, to give it to the recipient. They don't need to call you and say, look, right now I'm handing it over, make intention. No. You make the intention when you separate it, you make the intention when you give it to them. And then, or if you're not giving actual money, then you make the intention when you hire them to do it or make them in charge of doing it. And then whenever they give it, they make the intention when they're giving it. So zaman, yani, the detail of that also learned in the books of fiqh. So zaman, kayfiyya, the manner of making the intention depends on the act that you're doing. So reality of it, the ruling of it, the place of it, the time of it, the how of it. How is the intention done? That depends on the thing that you are intending. And shart, the condition for intention. What are the conditions for the validity of an intention? Intention, most cases, is necessary for the validity of an act. But what are the conditions necessary for the validity of an intention? One, Islam. The person must be Muslim. So obviously we're talking about the niyat shar'iyyah, niyat according to the sharia. The first condition is that it must be a Muslim. So a kafir cannot make a valid intention according to sharia. Tamyiz, the person must be at the age of discrimination, which according to the Shafi'i school in principle is when a person, a child, can eat, drink, clean up themselves without assistance. Most of the ulama say that happens about 7-8 years old. So a young child, the intention of a young child is invalid. The intentions of a young child before the age of tamyiz is invalid. Some actions that they do, the parent or the guardian, the adult, makes the intention on their behalf. If somebody takes a small child for hajj, for example, then you make the intention for them because their intention is invalid. And this is why mu'amalat, yani buying and selling and all of that from a child doesn't count according to the Shafi'i school. You know, when kids go to school, for example, and they, like sometimes your kid shows up at home with like a thing you didn't give it to them. Like you're at home, a parent is at home, the kid shows up with like 10 pencils and a toy car. It's like, where do you get that from? And they say, oh, my friend gave it to me. Well, your friend can't give according to Sharia. Adults can oversee it just to train them and everybody, like the parents are the ones really doing the deal. Because if you bought it and give it to them to use, actually your property. So the parents can do it just to teach them sharing and all that. But shara'an, That giving is not valid. So this is why the parent have to verify. Have to call the other parents, say, my kid came over like your kid's pencil, he said he gave it, is that cool? And heard the parents say, yeah, that's okay. Then is when it actually becomes a giving. Right? Child, because it's easy to rob them and all of that. I mean, there's a lot of other things. A kid shows up at a shop with like 100 ringgit. You can easily say, oh, that's only worth 2 gum. And then you take the kid's money. Also, one of the things that this means is that an intention is what makes something deliberate or indeliberate, under that, whatever the form of that English word is, non-deliberate, right? Or a deliberate action versus a mistake. This is why in the Sharia we say amd, as-sibyan khata. The deliberate, willful acts of kids, of children, by the Sharia are treated as mistakes. Because they're not yet at an age where they can actually have deliberation. Which also means that they cannot be, this is the important point, or the practical point, which also means that they cannot be punished. You can't beat a child. Young, 7, 6, 8. In fact, according to Shafi school, before the age of 10, you can't beat a child. So, and beating means beating. In the Shafi school, we are careful about words. So you can't do darb. You can't hit them. So somebody can say, oh, I poked my child. Is that permission, Shafi? You can poke your child. So if they... I'm not doing anything wrong. But if you strike them, that's not permissible. So, and you can't... I mean, now we're straying, but it's an important point because in Muslim societies, kids are beaten a lot. And worse than that, some people would say it's sunnah to beat children. I don't know where they get that from. But you hear people say, you've never heard that? I've heard people say it's sunnah. I don't know, where do you get that it's a sunnah? Anas ibn Malik said, ma daraba al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ma daraba al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I think it's sabiyan wala imra'atan biyadihi qat. Rasulullah never struck a child or a woman with his hands, ever. So, where did you get a sunnah to? But yeah, you can't strike them. And even when striking is permissible, there are conditions. Condition one, you cannot be angry. If you hit a child while you're angry, when it's permissible, so let's say they're 10 years old, and then the ulama differ as to what 10 means in the hadith. So some of them say 10 means the completion of 9, and the entrance into the 10th year. Some say no, the completion of 10 and the entrance into the 11th year. Because that's when you say a child is 10 years old. You can either say the child has entered his 10th year or you say he completed 10 years. So the ulama differ, which are we talking about when we say 10? But let's, whatever of the position you take, it's now permissible. A, it has to be for something that is punishable by Sharia. Can't be anything else, right? The child broke your TV that you watch movies with. You can't hit a child for that. You should thank the child. But you can't hit the child. Because Shara'an, that's not punishable. So it has to be something punishable by the Sharia. Second condition, you cannot do it when you're angry. Because if you hit while you're angry, you're not disciplining, you're satisfying your nafs. This is why some people when they hit and the kid shows that I'm not feeling it, they hit harder. That's a sign that you're satisfying your nafs. So until you're satisfied, you're gonna keep hitting. It's not permissible to hit somebody to satisfy your nafs. So you cannot be angry. The child must know what they're being hit for. Why? Because you're trying to instill discipline. If you hit the child, they don't know why they're being hit, you're not training them to do better because they don't know why. After the beat, they don't know what am I going to change to be better because you never said. It's just a whooping for no reason. So they must know because the idea, the only time you're permitted is to train, to instill discipline. So now you know, yeah. That's how many? Three. The fourth condition is that you can only hit if hitting is the only thing that works. So if you know speaking can work, you cannot hit. If you know silent treatment works, then you cannot hit. So if you know other methods work to instill discipline, then you can't hit. Tamyiz, as the conditions for the validity of intention, one is tamyiz, that the child be of an age of discrimination. The other condition for the validity of intention is that one knows what they're going to intend. If one doesn't know what they're going to intend, then the intention in reality is not there. For example, if somebody does not know what prayer is, somebody doesn't know what prayer is. The word prayer, when we say the word prayer, what comes to your mind? Because the word must have a referent. When I say cat, cat can only have a meaning if there's some picture that comes to your mind. Otherwise, you don't know what cat is, right? So when I say prayer, what comes to mind? There must be something that comes to mind in order for you to intend it, right? If I just make up a word right now and say, let's all intend to, and I make up a word, is that a real intention from anybody who does not know what that word means? No, because you don't know. You can't really intend something that you don't know. So it'll be equivalent to saying, I intend blank. Right? But you can't intend that. So one of the conditions you must know. So when somebody says, I intend to make wudu, you must know what constitutes wudu. I intend to pray. What constitutes prayer? I intend to fast. What does that mean? You must know. For Hajj, you must know. Some of the ulama say, because a lot of people don't know Hajj, the entire Hajj, and it becomes difficult for the Muslims to say, I intend Hajj, and know exactly what they intend, because it's not something a lot of people know. But they must know the part by part. So when they're at the ihram, you intend to make Hajj, have a general idea. When you're going to say, oh, I intend to stone, then you learn what it is, and then you make the intention. So you must know the thing that you're going to intend. If you don't know it, then the act becomes invalid. Let's say somebody who does not know how to make wudu comes. Say, teach me how to make wudu. You say, sit there. You're at the pipes. You say, sit there. The person sit. Turn on the pipe. They turn on the pipe. Wash your hands. And then they wash their hands. You say, okay, now wash your face. And while you're washing the face, say in your heart, I intend to make wudu. And then they did that. And then you say, now wash your hands. And then you go to the end. Is that person's wudu valid? No. Because when that person said, I intend to make wudu, they didn't know what wudu was. They didn't know what comes after the face. They're just doing it step by step as you told them. So it is only valid when you know what you're going to intend. So knowledge of the thing intended is a condition for the validity of the intention. And so that's the condition. The other condition is that the intention must be jazim. It must be firm. Because it cannot be called an intention otherwise. Somebody can't say, I feel like I want to intend. If somebody starts the prayer, Allahu Akbar, and the heart says, I think I might want to intend to pray Dhuhr. Is that an intention? That's not. Nobody. That's not an intention to do anything. That's a maybe, maybe, I want to, maybe not. So the intention must be firm. I intend to. It's a firm, done decision. And the intention must be firm and not contradicted by anything else. And the intention cannot be, the firmness of the intention cannot be made determinant by the happening or non-happening of something else. Or it cannot be, like we cannot place it on the occurrence of something else. So somebody can't say when he's praying Dhuhr, I intend to pray Dhuhr if my kid shows up in 10 minutes. Or unless my kid shows up in 10 minutes. Because now you're resting the intention on the occurrence or non-occurrence of something outside of what you're intending to do.
as we are overseas, right?
Yeah.
We're not sure of the prayer time.
Mm-hmm.
So can we do something like intend to pray Zuhur if it's Zuhur?
No. But why is because knowledge that the time has entered is a condition for the validity of prayer. So before you even pray, you have to know that the time has come. If you're in a position where you just cannot know, then is when you make your best effort to know, and then you pray afterwards. So for example, if somebody is locked up in a prison where they cannot see the sunlight. So for them it's just perpetual darkness. So now they have no way of knowing what day, time, month. So all they can do is like, okay, look, when I was out of prison, like now feels fajri. The body will have a certain memory, right? So it's going to say, now feels like that. So, and then you make that your fajr. And then you go, when I was outside of here, I can remember you used to take between fajr and dhuhr maybe 4 or 5 hours. So you try your best to calculate 5 hours and then you pray dhuhr. You try your best and then you do like that. That will be valid. And the last condition for the validity of intention is that the act, while you're making the intention, something that invalidates the act cannot be occurring. While the act is happening, and you're making the intention for the act, things that invalidate the act must be completely absent. Because if you're making an intention to do something while it is accompanied by something that invalidates the act, then the intention can never really happen. Because think about it this way, as soon as it occurs, it's broken, occurs broken, occurs broken. Why? Because accompanying something that invalidates the act. Husband and wife, for example, in the Shafi'i school, can they hold hands and make wudu? Because touching breaks the wudu. So you can't intend to make wudu while you're touching one another, it breaks the wudu. So those very in love couple who said, was like, let's hold hands for everything and they make wudu. So as you intend, you break, intend, you break, intend, you break, intend, you break, intend. So for the validity of the intention, whatever invalidates the act must be completely absent while you are making the intention. So these are the conditions for the validity of the act. So, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. I guess we'll have to stop there and then we'll continue in the next session. So if nothing else, will end. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر.